In a new Israeli massacre against Palestinians, Israel airstrike on Gaza safe zone killed 71 people and wounded hundreds. The U.S. Navy announces that it has destroyed 3 Houthi drones over the Red Sea. Government adopts measures to relocate headquarters of international organizations to Aden City. Good evening, welcome to Yemen Today News. I am Abir Ali. More than 70 Palestinians have been killed and hundreds are wounded in Israeli military strikes in Al-Mawasi, located west of Khan Yunis in the southern Gaza Strip. Gaza's Ministry of Health on Saturday put the death toll at 71 people and said 289 others were injured, including some critically wounded. Images from the scene showed Palestinians trying to rescue people from under the rubble, with children and paramedics among the wounded. This report has more details.
The Palestinian Resistance's media office announced on Saturday that at least 100 Palestinians were killed or wounded in an Israeli attack on Khan Yunis in Gaza, which Israel said targeted Mohammed al-Dayf, commander of al-Qassam brigades. The Ministry of Health in the Gaza Strip later reported that 71 Palestinians were killed in a raid on a displacement camp in al-Mawasi area in the southern Gaza Strip. The ministry denounced in a statement the heinous massacre of the occupation against citizens and displaced persons. An Israeli army radio correspondent said that the target of the raid was Mohammed al-Dayf, commander of al-Qassam brigades, the military wing of the Hamas movement, which was later confirmed by the Israeli army. Israeli Army Radio reported that al-Dayf was hiding in an above-ground location within the humanitarian zone west of Khan Yunis. It is not yet clear whether al-Dayf was injured in the raid, and his current condition is unknown, according to the Israeli newspaper Jerusalem Post. The Israeli army said it was looking into reports of dozens killed in raids near Khan Yunis in Gaza. Meanwhile, the Israeli Defense Minister's office confirmed that it is conducting an assessment of the operational situation within the security leaders regarding Gaza. The Palestinian Information Center reported that the Israeli bombing targeted the tents of displaced people in al-Mawasi area, noting that more than 20 ambulances arrived at Kuwait Hospital in Khan Yunis after the occupation massacre. The Israeli army bombed members of the civil defense as they attempted to retrieve the martyrs. The center stated that body parts of martyrs no more than 2 years old were strewn about, pointing out that the Palestinians are trying to transfer the injured to the Nasser Medical Complex by all means. According to Reuters, Hamas leader Sami Abu Zuhri stated that the Khan Yunis attack on civilians shows that Israel is not interested in reaching a ceasefire agreement. The Israeli army announced on Saturday that it was continuing its operations in the Gaza Strip nevertheless.
To impact this, joins me live from Dubai, Mr. Dimitri Dilani, the spokesperson of Fatah Reformist Democratic Faction. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Dilani.
Thanks for having me.
More than 71 Palestinians have been killed and hundreds are wounded in a new Israeli massacre on al-Mawasi area in Khan Yunis today. Israel claims targeting 2 senior Hamas officials. What's your take on that?
Well, Israel has made this false claim in order to draw attention away from the daily massacres Israel has been committing against civilians. Today, 70 civilians, all victims of today's massacres were civilians, namely children and women. Yesterday, the same story, the day before in Gaza. Before that, Al-Shaja'iya, a neighborhood of Gaza City, every day there's a massacre, and every day Israel tries to come up with any kind of excuse to draw attention away from the atrocities it causes. Today they have chosen to bring in the name of Mohammed Dayf into the mix of things, but our information clearly indicates that all victims, 100% of the victims today, were civilians, mainly women and children.
In your opinion, how would this development affect the ceasefire talks?
I believe that the state of Israel is trying to also create environment where the stopping the genocide talks, it's not a ceasefire, stopping the genocide talks would not succeed. Netanyahu sees a clear contradiction between his political interest as a person and as a political party, as well as his partners in the coalition. He sees that stopping the war is in direct contradiction of their personal interest. That's why they make up excuses, they try to escalate the massacres on the ground, they make false claims, whether in media or in diplomatic circles, all aiming at one goal, which is to extend the genocidal war they have been waging since October to the furthest possible time they could, because it will give them time to rebuild their tarnished image in front of their constituents, that all polls show that they will not elect them again.
I'm afraid that we'll leave it at this point, Mr. Dimitri. Thank you very much for your insight. The UNRWA chief, Philip Lazzarani, announced that the funds available to the agency are sufficient to continue work until September. Lazzarani warned that suffering Palestinians would lose a vital lifeline without UNRWA, and there is no alternative to the UNRWA. The United Nations chief appealed for funding to helping Palestinian refugees in Gaza. Secretary General Antonio Guterres told a donors conference that the agency known as UNRWA faces a profound funding gap. At the end of Guterres said that while the total amount of pledges won't be known until next week, he is confident there will be enough new money in its annual budget. Amnesty International considered Israel's repeated evacuation orders for residents of Gaza City amounts to illegal displacement, which is a war crime. The international organization added that the Palestinian civilians are facing multiple waves of displacement due to the Israeli aggression that has been ongoing for 9 months.
I'm Ghera from Gaza. I just want to tell you one thing. Your word is your weapon. Don't say I can't. Don't say I'm tired. Don't say I'm done. No. Our Palestinian issue is the issue for the whole world, especially here in Gaza. We are starving. We are so tired. So please talk about Gaza all the time. If you just have one follower, this one follower can make lots of differences. Please stand with us and don't leave us alone. Please. Thank you from Gaza. Thank you from my home. My home.
The United Nations confirmed that it is continuing its movement and efforts to secure the release of aid workers detained by the Houthi militia. The United Nations spokesman said that senior officials of the United Nations continue to work through all possible channels to secure the immediate and unconditional release of those arbitrarily detained by the Houthi militia. The Secretary General of the United Nations sent a message of solidarity to the organization's employees in Yemen. The The U.S. Central Command, CENTCOM, announces that its forces destroyed three drones belonging to the Houthi militia in areas under its control in Yemen. The Central Command confirmed that these aircraft represented an imminent threat to the United States coalition forces and commercial ships in the region. The U.S. Command added that it's taken these measures in order to protect freedom of navigation and keep international waters protected. The Presidential Leadership Council confirmed adherence to the clear agenda to participate in any dialogue on the economic file. The confirmation came in response to the UN envoy's addressed letter to Council to express his deep concern over the Central Bank of Yemen's suspension of the license of six banks. Today, the Yemeni city of Marib witnessed a massive popular demonstration in refusal to postpone the decision of the central bank in Aden. Activists on social media platforms called for this protest to support the decisions of the central bank and demand their rapid implementation. The organization also announced their rejection of any Arab or international pressure aimed at postponing those decisions related to the Central Bank of Yemen. The Yemeni government is adopting measures to being moving the headquarters of international organizations to Aden. Despite the fact of such measures are faced by criticism, this report has more details.
The Yemeni government has adopted a series of measures aimed at completing the transfer of international organizations' headquarters from Sana'a, under the control of the Houthi group, to the interim capital Aden. In recent weeks, the Houthis have intensified repressive measures against international humanitarian workers and UN agencies, arresting dozens of them on charges of spying for the U.S. Yemeni Prime Minister chaired a government meeting in Aden to evaluate the progress of humanitarian and developmental interventions by international and UN agencies. He also reviewed the measures taken to facilitate the relocation of organizations to Aden, enabling them to carry out their tasks without obstacles or restrictions. According to state media, the meeting highlighted ongoing violations by the Houthis against humanitarian and relief efforts, indicating the recent abduction of dozens of UN staff and international and local NGOs operating in Yemen. The government meeting condemned the Houthi group's arrests as a blatant violation of international humanitarian law and a direct threat to the lives, security, and safety of humanitarian workers. It also emphasized the legal, ethical, and humanitarian responsibility of the Yemeni government to protect citizens in militia-controlled areas. Yemen's government meeting approved actions to handle recent humanitarian developments, focusing on ongoing Houthi violations against international organizations and their staff. They instructed ministries to facilitate the relocation of these agencies to Aden, ensuring services reach all Yemeni citizens.
Coming up in the news. Tropical diseases outbreak threatens thousands of displaced Yemenis families. Welcome back. U.S. President Joe Biden resumes his election campaign to support his candidacy for a second presidential term. At a rally in Michigan, President Joe Biden strongly rejected speculations that he might withdraw from U.S. presidential elections under a chance of "don't withdraw." Biden said there has been a lot of speculations recently, and he answered that he is a candidate and he won't change that. Experts say Iran is turning Yemen into an open market for drugs, according to a report issued by the Yemeni Network for Rights and Freedoms. Iran is considered the main focus of drugs smuggled by the Houthi militia. The director of the Narcotics Control Department in Thai's government believes that Iran is using its arms, including the Houthi militia, to export drugs to the region. The Ministry of Public Health warned of catastrophic repercussions due to the decline in foreign funding. The Minister of Health said that the decrease in funding will undermine efforts to ensure access to the basic services package and will affect 9 million people. The minister pointed out that this will cause the closure of nearly 700 health facilities and 60 hospitals and care centers, and will also leave 500,000 women without reproductive health services. The cholera epidemic has expanded in Hajj government southern Yemen. A medical source warned that the epidemic continues to spread in light of the absence of health awareness, especially as some areas suffer from water pollution, lack of community awareness, and a deteriorating health situation. At a time when Marib's health sector is facing severe shortage of medical supplies, about 204 cases of diphtheria and cholera are increasing due to unsanitary conditions preventing displaced communities in the city. This report has more.
In Marib, displaced people are suffering from continued outbreaks of infectious and deadly epidemics, especially among women and children. In Assuwait camp, the only field hospital is helpless in the face of dozens of cases of diphtheria and cholera that it receives on a daily basis. Equipped with a severe shortage of medicines and medical supplies, the hospital is unable to keep up with the influx of patients, which only compounds as sanitary conditions devolve.
At this field hospital in Assuwaidat camp, we are receiving a great number of acute watery diarrhea cases, which are characteristic of cholera disease. We are also dealing with the cases of throat inflammation and diphtheria. Pharmacy supplies are limited to first aid kits. They do not stock any of our prescribed medications. In this camp, waterborne illnesses including dengue fever, cholera, and diphtheria are the most common.
There are 244 camps for displaced persons in Marib Governorate, including Assuwait camp. Many camps lack basic utilities and health care that would allow for disease prevention. The number of diphtheria cases verified by laboratories rose to 108, including 7 fatal cases, in less than a month and a half. Meanwhile, the Marib Governorate Health Office reported more than 400 instances of cholera. The acute shortage of food and proper shelter, the paucity of clean water and sanitation facilities, and the lack of health awareness all contribute to the displaced people's suffering.
Here is a reminder of the main headlines. In a new Israeli massacre against Palestinians, Israeli airstrike on Gaza safe zone killed 71 people and wounded hundreds. The U.S. Navy announces that it has destroyed 3 Houthi drones over the Red Sea. Government adopts measures to relocate headquarters of international organizations to Aden City. This is the end of the news. Thank you for streaming with us. It was Abirali.